Nathan, let's talk about Canada's labor market, specifically worker shortages and that impact to Canadian businesses and their production. What is your data telling you?
I mean, I think our data has been telling us, you know, for a while now that lack of workers has been a significant constraint for businesses. You know, that's true in Canada, but it's also true abroad. It's just been very difficult for businesses to keep up with the orders. We've seen, you know, globally pretty strong consumer demand, particularly for things like physical merchandise. That's filtered through to stronger demand kind of across the supply chain. And they're simply, you know, haven't been enough workers for businesses to respond. You know, that, you know, also adding to some of these, you know, global supply chain issues that have also been a challenge for businesses. So I think, you know, the net result of that has been in part, you know, all of the inflation pressures that we're still seeing, where you have a lot of demand chasing limited ability to produce, and that's pushing prices higher. And a big chunk of that challenge with producing more is its labor shortages.
Let's just go back. You've touched on it somewhat. What has happened? What's changed?
I mean, I think we've just had a really rapid recovery in labor markets from the pandemic. We had a major economic downturn in 2020, particularly in the initial lockdown periods. So employment fell, the unemployment increased sharply, but the government transfers to households during that period were just unprecedented. So household incomes actually increased in aggregate pretty substantially in Canada when you include government transfers in as a source of income for households. So, you know, there was a lot of purchasing power, you know, as pandemic restrictions ended. The economy bounced back fairly quickly, generated a lot of demand for workers. And we simply ran out of those workers. And it's been very, you know, it's different by industry. You know, the travel and hospitality sector in particular has struggled for a while with rehiring from the pandemic. And the reason for that is that, you know, a lot of workers that were in those industries pre-pandemic, you know, switched industries, you know, during the lockdowns to some, you know, lower contact services that were more likely to stay open. So in a lot of cases, the workers just simply aren't there anymore. You have a huge, you know, historically high share of the available workforce in Canada is currently already employed.
You mentioned that sector shift. Let's talk about the demographic and what our population looks like.
Yeah, and I mean that's one of those, you know, structural demographic trends. You know, that we've noted before, you know, won't end even as we get closer to what we think will be a recession in the year ahead. Labor force participation rate, so the share of the population overall that's actively either working or looking for work, have been declining, you know, for decades really at this point. But virtually all of that decline can be explained just in that there's a larger share of the population that's hitting retirement age. If you control for that factor, labor force participation has never been stronger in Canada. But that kind of a longer run demographic trend is something that there's not really a lot that you can do about in the near term. We still are probably only about halfway through this big wave of retirements as the baby boom generation starts to hit retirement age. So that kind of downward pressure, you know, structurally longer term on labor supply, you know, will continue for you know, really the next decade.
Let's talk about pressures on wages. Our editor-in-chief, Kevin Carmichael, recently wrote a piece where he suggested that workers will have bargaining power. How do you see this?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're seeing that already. I think, you know, businesses have been reporting for a while, you know, that they expect to try and increase employment counts, and also that they think that they'll have to pay more in order to do that, as well as to retain their existing workforce. So, you know, we have seen, you know, wage growth in Canada accelerated to, you know, above 5% per year, you're still, you know, just kind of catching up to inflation. At that, those rates are not even catching up to inflation yet, but certainly we're seeing wage pressure, wage pressures emerge. And, you know, it makes sense if you look at, just the levels of unemployment are very low. We had an increase in unemployment in August, but still to a 5.4% unemployment rate. That was still, you know, below pre-pandemic levels. And at the same time, we have, job openings running at 60% or so above pre-pandemic levels. So effectively, we have, 60% more job openings competing for fewer available unemployed workers. So that is an environment where you expect, workers to have a little more bargaining power and expect to see more wage growth.
Ultimately, what is the answer to labor shortages?
Well, I mean, I think, the current economic backdrop is very strong, but we talked already, about how that's feeding into some of the inflation pressures that we're seeing. Central banks are responding to that right now with really aggressive interest rate hikes. So we don't expect these very strong labor market conditions to last. We still expect, labor markets will soften over the latter half of this year and into 2023, where we do have a moderate recession in our base case macroeconomics assumptions. Beyond that, I think there is still this longer run demographic challenge that means that labor is going to still be in short supply even after this next downturn that we expect. We might have, some temporary easing in labor shortages in the year ahead, but those challenges we think will be back for businesses, post pandemic or post the next recession.
Does immigration weave into that answer?
Yeah, I mean it absolutely does, and it's we do have some pretty aggressive immigration targets now. Relative to kind of pre-pandemic levels. So that'll help fill, some of those jobs. But we also know, having more people coming to our country, also does increase demand here. Immigrants are also consumers. So as you bring in more people, you're increasing the supply of labor. You're also potentially increasing, the number of jobs that need to be filled. So it's something that helps, but it doesn't fully offset, these longer run demographic challenges. So that's where you start to think, some of these, what we're seeing in terms of labor market tightness and upward pressure on wages will probably persist, beyond next year. And then it's really, how do businesses deal with that? And there are, as wages go up, for example, the cost, relative cost of investing in machinery equipment declines. So that's actually a fairly positive scenario if businesses, respond with more productivity enhancing investments. That can mean both more profits for businesses and higher wages because the size of the economic pie is getting bigger. So not all of the impacts of this are negative by any means. And it's from a worker's perspective, certainly higher wages are in the longer run are a good thing.